Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on crntalk.com, also available in stunning high-definition video on crntalk.com, also facebook.com/crntalk. You can drop us a note there. Also on our custom-built CRN Roku channel, available for free in the Roku store, and of course on Tiki Live and directly on crntalk.com. I'm joined, as always, by the one and only, an active attorney, U.S. Army vet, Juris Doctorate in Law, undergraduate degree in physics, which we're going to address shortly, and author of a book that has been proven to be a guideline for the Supreme Court now and in the future. That book, America, an Illusion of Freedom, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard Nixon. Sir, how are you?
Thank you. Very good. I'm trying to find something here. We've had much talk about fusion and fission. To begin with, I think my undergraduate degree in physics comes in handy there because fission is basically the splitting of the atom, and fusion is the combining of the atom. And basically what's happened here of late that you've heard on the news, that fusion has been employed, that is pushing parts of the atomic nuclei together and generating this tremendous energy. And I'm going to read this only because it's important to get all the words right. It has a laser beam that's fired at this little apparatus. And it says that the laser beams enter at the top and come out of the bottom of a cylinder, and it vaporizes it. And this generated an inward onslaught of X-rays that compresses a BB-sized fuel pellet of deuterium and tritium. Those are the heaviest forms of hydrogen. Now, this is interesting here. In a brief moment lasting less than 100 trillionth of a second, two megajoules, that's just a unit of energy, roughly the equivalent of a pound of TNT, bombarded the hydrogen pellet, outflowed a flood of neutron particles, the product of the fusion, which carried about 3 megajoules of energy, or an energy gain of about 1 megajoule, as they say. Now, that sounds good. Everybody's congratulating these people at the Lawrence Liverpool situation, site. However, if you read on, and this is where my physics training did me a little bit of good and maybe got me in some trouble here. Near the end, it says, although the latest experiment produced a net energy gain compared to the energy of the megajoules in the incoming laser beams, the energy needed to create
The laser shot,
yes, of 300 megajoules, and it had to come off the electrical grid in order to generate that brief laser pulse. So in other words, in order to generate 2 megajoules, in order to produce 3 megajoules, they had to expand, as far as I can see, 300 megajoules to generate that laser beam.
So it looks like
a loser to me.
It looks like maybe we're in the infancy of it. Maybe perhaps the plan is to use that 300 megajoules from renewable energy, but we shall see. Stick around, you guys. We're here in the Legal Lounge. Got a lot to talk about today. Stay with us.
But you know what that reminds me?
You're experiencing pain, back pain, shoulder, elbow, or hand pain, pain from a sports injury. If so, schedule a visit with Dr. Michael Sheps, the leading expert in laser therapy for pain management. Call 310-873-4422 or go to drsheps.com. Experience Epic T, the breakthrough laser therapy system that Dr. Sheps developed to make you pain-free in less time. Laser therapy is a non-invasive, safe, and effective in-office procedure that penetrates deep into your skin without damaging the tissue. It perfectly targets areas of pain to promote fast, natural healing. Relax your muscles, ease muscle spasms, joint stiffness, and arthritis pain while increasing blood circulation. For over 25 years, Dr. Sheps has helped Olympic athletes and sports enthusiasts alike get back in the game. Schedule your visit with Dr. Sheps at his Brentwood office in California. Call 310-873-4422 or visit drsheps.com. That's drsheps.com. 310-873-4422.
And We are back in the Legal Lounge. Once again, thank you so much for joining us today. We have a big show. We're going to talk about a couple of interesting cases, Rada versus Jennings. We're going to talk about SB 1327, and we're going to talk about pasta later on in the show. But real fast, before we get into the meat of the show, I wanted to say something, a sad note here. Here in Los Angeles, we broadcast live out of Los Angeles, California, and a local celebrity has passed away. Mountain Lion P22.
Yeah, he was my buddy.
He was my guy too. He was he was the lone cougar in the Los Feliz area. He was kind of a celebrity, a local hero, because he was the lone puma running around Griffith Park, which is about 1,000 acres here in Los Angeles. And he was kind of hemmed in between the 405 freeway and the 101 freeway. And so he made the Los Feliz Hills and Griffith Park his home. He was there for over 12 years, which is pretty long life for a cougar out in the wild. But sadly, he was showing some signs of some distress, some ill health, and wildlife conservationists were able to track him down and tranquilize him, because all cougars in the LA area, most of them that we know about, have radio geolocation tags. They found him in someone's backyard. They took him in for an evaluation, and it turns out that he was very, very ill. He was suffering the effects of being hit by a car. He had a kidney failure, heart failure, and like I said, he was 12 years old, which was quite old. And so he was sadly, tragically, humanely euthanized down at the San Diego Safari Animal Park. So P22, all good kitties go to heaven, and he's been called back to his ancestors. And so rest in peace, P22.
Mike, while we're on the subject, I used to have gophers in my yard. I have a pretty good size yard, 100 by 300. And I used to have gophers, and then suddenly I had a whole bunch of feral cats and no more gophers. The land is totally flat. Well, about 2 months ago, I noticed I had gophers all over my front yard. I mean, I must have 12 holes there now. I also noticed that when I went into my shed and moved a box, there was a dead cat.
Mm.
I also noticed that I went behind a bush. Now, why I went there to move some things, I don't know. There was a dead possum. Then I went to the middle of the yard. There's another dead cat. The only thing remaining was the skeleton, the teeth, and so on. And I'm thinking maybe it's P22's brother-in-law that's in my yard, because somebody's killing these animals. I don't get it.
Yeah, well, also, I mean, out here in the valley, we do have hawks and we have coyotes, which are definitely predators. But all those people out there, too, make sure if you're anywhere in the country, if not the world, don't use rat poison. If you want to, if you have a vermin problem, like Richard said, get a cat or get some traps. Do not use the actual chemical poison, because other critters will get into that, or the rats themselves will get into that, and then the coyotes, mountain lions, or cats will eat the rat, and
that's
they will.
Exactly right. That happened to a neighbor. That's right.
Yeah. All right. Moving on. So this is interesting. You brought this to my attention, Richard. This is just, you know, something as an aside that I think that the listeners really need to pay attention to. This has to do with Chinese companies purchasing farmland. And you brought this to my attention. I have some documentation here that over 2.3% of all agricultural farmland owned here in the United States is owned by foreign countries, including communist China. And most alarmingly, we've seen a Chinese company purchase a North Dakota farmland, which has raised U.S. security concerns. Chinese company, the Fufeng Group, bought over 300 acres of land near Grand Forks, North Dakota, to set up a milling plant. However, this particular piece of property is within 20 minutes of Grand Forks Air Force Base in Montana, the site of one of our, I believe, 3 ICBM fields.
Yes.
And so we were kind of throwing around whether or not there is any sort of statutes on the books, whether or not foreign companies, or even nationally owned foreign companies, can purchase agricultural land. And it turns out there are certain states that do require registration, but there's no outright ban. However, friend of the show, Kristi Noem, who's the governor of North Dakota, she and other members of Congress have introduced H.R. 3995, a bill to amend the Agricultural Foreign Investment Disclosure Act to require additional reporting and public disclosure of information about foreignly owned agricultural land. Richard, why is it important that perhaps we keep an eye on the Chinese government through their vassal companies buying property in the United States?
Well, it's interesting, because I started off thinking I'm absolutely against the Chinese buying any of our property here, especially farmland, because they could simply turn it to fallow and not produce anything, which would reduce our agricultural output. But then after researching it further, I find out that only 3% of our farmland in this country is owned by foreigners, and only about 1% of that 3% is Chinese. Yeah. However, interestingly enough, the Chinese, their purchase is very strategic. They've got their land that they purchased, as you said, next to a different Air Force bases, and if I'm not mistaken, the other one is near a nuclear silo. Am I mistaken?
Yeah, the one in North Dakota is right close to a nuclear silo, to a missile field, and one in Texas close to Barksdale Air Force Base on the Louisiana border is where we have our B-52 bases.
And I'm wondering how North Dakota, how Kristi Noem permitted that to happen. It must have happened years ago when it was permitted somehow, but I think she's on board now trying to undo it. My problem is, what does the federal government have to do with it? Again, I get back to that same old Constitution. Who's authorized to do this? I think the state of North Dakota can, because other states have done that. They have simply limited or prohibited foreign countries from owning, whether it be farmland or residential property or whatever, owning property in their state, period. I don't think we need the federal government to babysit us again.
But also this brings up another point. It's not just the Chinese, the CCP buying up farmland. It's also these so-called billionaire altruists, such as Bill Gates, such as Ted Turner, who have bought hundreds of thousands, if not millions of acres of agricultural land to let sit, like you said, fallow, because they believe that corporate ranching, corporate farming is destroying the planet.
Yes. Now, there is such a thing, I wasn't really prepared to argue that issue, but there is such a thing as adverse possession. And what it has to do with, very simply, is if a person owns land, at least on paper, and he ignores it, doesn't do anything with that land, and someone else, if you will, squats on that land and produces it, uses it, there, after so many years, that land can become the new person's land. Now, one of the exceptions to that is if the original owner, that is the paper owner, actually continues to pay taxes, then that squatter can never own that. But the purpose of that, the rationale for that, is the government believes that all land should be productive. And they want to reward people for using productive means on that land. And they don't reward people who leave it fallow. It seems to me that we could go after Bill Gates and Turner and so on, and essentially do something to make them, maybe they are using it, I don't know. I understood that they were purposely going to pull out of agriculture to reduce the carbon footprint of this country, and that was one way to do it.
Well, I mean, like you said, this land has been, I mean, the Homestead Act of 1847 pretty much opened the West where people could go, and if so long, if he's, like you said, if they produce, if they work the land and make that land productive, they then get ownership. I think perhaps somebody should see something else. I mean, we have so much open land here in the West, but yet this terrible housing crisis and a terrible concentration of industry in these urban centers, let's spread it out. Let's make this land actually usable rather than just sitting there and owned by either the Chinese Communist Party or some billionaires. Stick around, you guys. We'll be right back right after the break. Stay with us.
Yeah, you're absolutely.
Hi, Fred Dwyer here. If you suffer from a serious chronic illness, heartburn, poor sleep, fatigue, brain fog, you need Balance 7. Balance 7 improves the acid-alkaline balance in the body. The right pH helps unlock the immune system. It also allows for better hydration and nourishment during times of medication and stress. Balance 7 works. I know. I use it every day. Now you can try it free. Balance 7 is offering chronic illness sufferers a free gallon of Balance 7 for the first 100 callers. That's an $87 value free. So call 800-793-9039 and mention my name, Fred. The first 100 callers suffering with a chronic illness get a free gallon of Balance 7. So call 800-793-9039, code word Fred, or visit balance7.com. That's balance, the number 7.com. 800-793-9039, code word Fred.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it, you could junk it, or you could donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-785-9618. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It will be towed away for free, and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you for calling, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to many exciting locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now, 1-800-785-9618. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher. Call now, 1-800-785-9618. That's 1-800-785-9618.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's vine-to-bar chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's vinetobar.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Thank you once again so much for joining us. We appreciate it. All previous sessions are available on YouTube. Search for CRN Digital Talk on YouTube. So, Richard, Christmas came early for you and I, because one of the great laments we have, not only in this show, but in your book, is how that the Supreme Court's, as you say, those nine unelected justices sitting high up there in robes, often make law usurping the power of the people.
Absolutely.
Through the legislative branch. But now we have, finally, a nice example of Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2 in action. First of all, what is Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2? Why is it important? And why is it important in this Rauta versus Jennings case?
Okay, under Article 3 of the Constitution, Section 2, Paragraph 2, it talks about all cases affecting ambassadors, other public ministers and consuls, and those in which a state shall be a party, the Supreme Court shall have original jurisdiction. So that's basically the only way you can get straight into the Supreme Court is to be in one of those situations. In all the other cases before mentioned, the Supreme Court shall have appellate jurisdiction, both as to law and to fact, with such exceptions and under such regulations as the Congress shall make. Now, the significance of this is, first of all, no one ever mentions this particular Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2. It's basically saying that rather than the Supreme Court being in charge of Congress and the president, Congress is really in charge of the Supreme Court if it chooses to do so. There are many reasons for why they choose not to do so, and one of them is plausible deniability. They want people to blame people for...
They want to blame the court because the court's not accountable to voters
exactly.
As the legislators are.
So what we've got here is a situation where, I'll read it very briefly, Mr. Rauta appeals the district court denying his request for a temporary restraining order to prevent the government from removing him from the United States. In the district court, Matthias argued that deportation prior to a ruling on his motion to reopen would violate his due process rights, the Convention Against Torture, and the Immigration and Nationalities Act. In denying his motion, the district court concluded that it lacked jurisdiction to reach Matthias's claims. We agree with the district court and affirm. Now, before we leave that case, Mike, very quickly, I want to read the exact quote here. Matthias argues and so on and so on and so on. But what the court quotes now is section 1252G, which says, no court shall have jurisdiction to hear any cause or claim by or on behalf of any alien arising from the decision or action by the Attorney General to commence proceedings, adjudicate cases, or execute removal orders against any alien. So this is the Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, in motion. It's actually acting here, where the Ninth Circuit, recognizing the law and recognizing the Constitution, that the Congress had every right to limit the Ninth Circuit's jurisdiction, and the Ninth Circuit is doing just that. It is refusing to hear the case.
And this is, you mentioned U.S. Code 1252 subsection G, exclusive jurisdiction.
Yes.
Except as provided in this section, blah, 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 notwithstanding, blah, 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 any alien arising from a decision or an action by the Attorney General to commence proceedings, adjudicate cases, or execute removal orders against alien under this chapter. Congress wrote that.
Exactly.
And this is the court, the Ninth Circuit, no less.
Of all people.
Of all people, the Ninth Circuit adhering to the actual statute that Congress wrote, which is all well and proper in the way that the founders intended under the United States Constitution, 1789, Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2.
This is why I say Congress had this tool in their toolbox all these years.
They still have it.
Yes, and they could have at any time when they were passing a law or writing a law to be signed by the president, they could very simply say, and this is not subject to judicial review. That would mean that that law is the law. As soon as the ink dries, that's the law, and the Supreme Court cannot get involved waiting a year and a half for the Supreme Court to speak on it. This would be law right now, and the writers of that law would be responsible to the people at this moment, as soon as it's passed.
So, and I'm going to ask you this. I'm going to pose this question to you, and I'd like you to ruminate on it and then address it after the break. Is this particular statute and the philosophy behind it and Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2 is in tension with Marbury versus Madison? And how does that tension resolve? And I want you to answer that question right after the break. Stay with us.
Mold. No more damage. No more outdated old bathroom. No more slipping and hurting. No more stress. Make your ordinary bathroom extraordinary for only $99 per month. New shower, new door, new tub, new wall, new anti-slip technology. Be stress-free. Call 800-973-5411. BCI Bath and Shower is made in America for the highest quality. Ask about our military and senior discounts. Your dream bathroom in as little as one day. First 50 callers save $1,500 on a Neverclear glass treated door. Call now for free premium color upgrades. 800-973-5411. Call BCI Bath and Shower, the leader in bathroom remodeling. Be smart, safe, and stay a step ahead of inflation with our interest-free financing options. Call 800-973-5411. Love your bathroom with free upgrades. Call 800-973-5411. 800-973-5411.
The smartest way for you to get the lowest prices on your plane tickets, domestic or international, is to call SmartFares, first or last, but you've got to call us before you book your plane tickets. Fly anywhere in the world, fly anywhere in the U.S., and SmartFares can save you up to 75% on your plane tickets. We have the lowest airline ticket prices on over 500 airlines, and you've got a great 12-hour free cancellation window. Plus, with our live agent help, you can always get fast help and fast answers. So on your next trip, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, how about right now? Pick up your phone and call SmartFares. Plus, save up to 75% on your plane reservation. So call right now. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644. 800-915-2644.
Hi, this is Fred Dreyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Now you can get generic Viagra shipped to your door for about $2 a pill. Get the same impact for less. Call Steel Man Pills now and get the same blue pill for about $2 a pill. Call now for the 50-pill special and save even more. Plus, get a free bonus.
800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. That's 800-605-1683.
Hi, I'm Dennis Bono. Join me every Saturday at 6 p.m. and Sunday at 3 p.m. for the Dennis Bono Show live from the entertainment capital of the world, Las Vegas. Enjoy this fun-filled hour with my celebrity friends as they perform, visit, and have lots of fun with me in front of a live audience in the showroom at the South Point Hotel. Please join me Saturday, 6 p.m. Pacific, Sunday, 3 p.m. Pacific, right here on CRN Radio and CRNTalk.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Thank you so much once again for joining us. For the break, we were talking about Rada versus Jennings. This is an immigration case. This has to do with Mr. Rada, who is a El Salvadorian illegal immigrant and MS-13 gang member and criminal, who was given an order to leave the country. They said pretty much get out. And he filed a habeas petition here. And the Ninth Circuit, no less, following Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, under 8 U.S.C., Subsection 1252, Subsection G, court said, and once again, I need to reiterate, the Ninth Circuit said this, and said, our hands are tied. We cannot take a habeas petition up because Congress wrote a law saying that we cannot do so. So, Richard, how does Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, jive with Marbury versus Madison?
Thank you very much for that. Mike? First of all, for those who may have forgotten about Marbury versus Madison, it's been a while. It's one of the first cases we talked about in our show, which goes back a couple years. Marbury versus Madison is an 1803 case, which basically concluded, without giving all the facts, it concluded that the Supreme Court had jurisdiction to void acts of Congress. Now, Thomas Jefferson was president at the time, 1803, and he said this was unbelievable, that if such power existed in the Constitution, it certainly would have been written down somewhere. It's not written. The Supreme Court Justice Marshall simply pulled that out of the air somewhere and said that the Supreme Court is more attuned to knowing what the law is and what the Constitution says and so on. So they're more qualified to do that. Thomas Jefferson argued, no, those of us who are writing the laws, those of us in the legislature, we can call in all kinds of people, professors and lawyers and whoever, and we can ask them what their opinion is if we were to pass this particular piece of legislation, what their opinion is, whether it's constitutional or not. So actually, Congress probably is more qualified to make that determination. In any event, we've lived with Marbury versus Madison since 1803. And what's amazing about it, and because of my absolutely fantastic research capabilities and my crack research staff, I was able to find this Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, which absolutely contradicts Marbury versus Madison. That is to say, Congress is in charge of the Supreme Court, not the Supreme Court in charge of Congress, if the Congress chooses to do so.
And so, ergo, if it, because of the procedures laid out in Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, Congress tomorrow could write a bill, vote on that bill, and send it to the president, pretty much abolishing Marbury versus Madison.
That's
saying
right.
that the under the constitutional provisions outlined in Article 3, Section 2, Paragraph 2, that the Supreme Court cannot exercise judicial review and void acts of Congress.
Absolutely. And in fact, as you know, you've read my book several times, Mike.
Indeed.
Chapter 8 says just that. That's one of the solutions that I give in the very first chapter, is to have Congress use this authority and strip the Supreme Court of overstepping their bounds like they did in Marbury versus Madison.
And why don't they do that? Congress loves to have power. They're power-hungry individuals. Why wouldn't they want to have that power where they're not subject to review from nine unelected justices in Hyde
and Rhodes? Because people have said it's plausible deniability. In other words, instead of being responsible for the law and having no one comment on it any further, the situation we have right now, for instance, regarding Obamacare. Obamacare was passed, and it was a year and a half before the Supreme Court said it was constitutional. In the meantime, everybody's wondering what's going to happen. And if we didn't have that judicial review, the Congress would have been responsible for that bill. And if we liked the bill or not liked the bill, our voting could have reflected whether we liked it or not. Instead, we wait for the Supreme Court to decide. And then who do we criticize? The Supreme Court. Justice Roberts.
Because the Supreme Court is not held accountable to
the voters.
They're
not responsible. That's right.
Well, there you go, folks. If you want to actually see the founders' intent, where the Congress makes laws, the people's branch, the elected representatives rather than the Supreme Court, maybe write, text, email your local congressperson and maybe drop that legislation. So, all right, let's move on to a friend of, not necessarily a friend of the show, Governor Gavin Newsom. He is one of the most performative governors in the country, and definitely has got the eyes open for a presidential run in the not too far future. He wrote a bill and signed it into law here in California, which is closely modeled over Texas law SB 8. Of course, we've talked about extensively Texas law SB 8, which would allow a unique enforcement mechanism to protect unborn fetuses. It allowed for anybody who was aiding and abetting in the act of an abortion after a certain number of weeks, I believe 12 weeks or whenever a heartbeat is detected, it allowed for civil litigation against those parties by private citizens. Governor Newsom wanted to make a point, and so he wrote a very similar law with the same enforcement mechanism regarding firearms here in the state of California. Briefly, the SB 1327, the bill would create a private right of action for any person against any persons who, one, within the state, manufactures or causes to be manufactured, distributes, transports, or imports into sale. Manufacturers or causes to be manufactured, blah, 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 blah. Any lens, any firearms, like blah, 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 purchases, sells. Pretty much it's all about guns, folks.
Right.
We're right up against a break here, but we have a Daily Journal article here for the paper of record here. It's the headline, Newsom Knows Gun Law is Unconstitutional, Opponents Argue.
Yes.
And in the Mr. Newsom himself gives up the bag because, as his spokesman says, quote, as the governor has explained from the outset, California's preference is that neither law be tolerated, either SB 8 or SB 1327. But if the provision of SB 8 withstands a constitutional challenge, then so too must SB 1327. He's pretty much saying here he doesn't think that SB 8 is constitutional, and he drafted 1327 after SB 8, ergo SB 8, SB 1327 is unconstitutional as well. We're going to talk about that right after the break. Sorry, I talked for so long about that.
Okay, Mike.
But stick around. We'll be right back and discuss this issue. Stay with us. Thank you.
Are you paying too much for term life insurance? There's a tremendous price war among the major term life companies. Rates have dropped dramatically in the past 2 years. For example, a man age 45 non-tobacco user, $1 million of coverage is only $75 per month, level for the next 10 years. Or a man age 50 non-tobacco user can buy $500,000 of coverage for a monthly premium of only $110. Guaranteed not to change for the next 20 years. That's right, level rates for 20 years. And if you're a smoker, we have great rates for you as well. At the Term Lifeline, we specialize in policies of $500,000 and above. So if you're looking for new or replacement term life insurance, call right now for a free quote.
Rates and availability may vary by state. Sample rate quotes are based on preferred non-tobacco underwriting exam required to qualify.
800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. That's 800-349-6855.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's Vine to Bar Chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's VINETOBAR.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
And we're back at the Legal Lounge. Thank you so much once again for joining us. Talking about Governor Newsom, a.k.a. Gruesome Newsom. He is doing some performative lawmaking here with this SB 1327, which pretty much means you can sue anybody who provides a firearm in a lot of different scenarios. Definitely unconstitutional, not only because of the Second Amendment, but also certain case law established under D.C. versus Heller and McDonald versus Chicago. What were your thoughts about this when you read this article about Newsom knows gun laws unconstitutional, opponents argue, Richard?
Well, what's interesting about it is California law SB 1327 is pretty much identical to the Texas law SB 8. And you'll recall that under SB 8, which is currently the law now, but it's pending a trial, a temporary restraining order was denied, and so it's going forward, but we're going to go to trial on this before the Supreme Court, or a decision, I should say, before the Supreme Court. And what's interesting is during that argument over the temporary restraining order, Governor Newsom said, I'm going to do what in California, what the Texans are doing in Texas, this SB 8, which basically says that that the Texas law allows individuals, but not the state, to sue anyone who assists someone getting an abortion. So what I'm going to do, that is Mr. Newsom is saying, I'm going to give the people in the state permission to sue anyone who uses, owns, whatever, causes damage regarding a gun in California. And if one is constitutional, the other is constitutional, and vice versa. The interesting thing is Attorney General Bonta has taken the position that the Texas law is unconstitutional. So you've got so if that's unconstitutional, so is SB 1327 here in California.
And oh, just real fast, Bonta, no friend of conservatives. Right. He seems like he's taking a principled position here, where he's saying, look, if we believe that SB 8 is unconstitutional, we would be hypocrites to enact similar legislation using the same constitutional pretext as SB 8. Continue.
Well, that's true, but his argument has been on the First Amendment.
Really?
And I'm not sure where I see a First Amendment position here. In other words, what we've done, if we've gone over this before, but originally— the Constitution, under Article 3 again, permitted an individual to sue a state. And then because we didn't like the fact that an individual was given too much power to go after a state, they passed, that is to say, the Congress passed the 11th Amendment, which said you cannot sue. An individual cannot sue another state. Yep. Then they figured out, well, wait a minute, that's not good either. We want to have people to have access to the officials of the state, not suing the state itself. So you had an exception to the 11th Amendment. Now you've got either more of an exception in that Joe Blow, anybody, can now sue the state, or individuals, I should say, on behalf of the state.
Yeah, state actors.
And they're acting as state people, but they're not agents. And they're now suing people who helped anyone to get an abortion, or in California, anyone who helped them purchase a gun or whatever. So I have problems. Maybe I didn't focus on it right, but I'm not sure where the First Amendment comes in there.
I don't know, I have no idea what sort of First Amendment challenge would be here. Maybe freedom of association, but I mean, the governor himself, in a statement from the governor's press office, quotes, as the governor has explained from the outset, California's preference is that neither law be tolerated, right. But if a provision of SB 8 withstands a constitutional challenge, then so too must SB 1327's identically worded provision. So this is like a canard, a gambit that Newsom is attempting here. He's saying, look, if SB 8 is constitutional, we're going to go tit for tat and we're going to do it with Second Amendment rights here in California.
Correct.
If it's not constitutional, then ergo, if 1327 is not constitutional, ergo, SB 8's not constitutional. One thing I think Newsom's got wrong here is, many things that I think Newsom's got wrong, is that I think his logic is faulty because the Second Amendment is an enumerated constitutional right. The citizens shall be able to bear and keep arms.
Correct.
Whereas the right to abortion, especially post-Dobbs, which was settled on the right to privacy, has now been settled as bad law.
And it exists nowhere in the Constitution. So you're exactly right. They're starting with two different foundations. And so I don't think if one fails, the other has to or must. But it'll be interesting to see what the Supreme Court does.
Yeah, right now, I mean, like you said, there was the SB 8 stands. It is enforced right now.
Right.
A restraining order was not enjoined, but the Supreme Court did give a writ of certiorari and will hear the case within the next couple days.
Yes.
And so, keep your eyes on this space real fast. But real fast, Richard, we got about a minute before this break. These kind of performative legal maneuvers by politicians, it's kind of a waste of not only time, but taxpayers' money, right?
Well, I don't know. You see, these politicians, they always walk a tightrope between their personal predilections and how they would like the world to be, and representing their clients and what they know or their constituents, what they know their constituents who voted for them would like. So I don't know how serious Bunta is in taking this position. Most of his supporters might have agreed with him that he's got to take this position. It may have been principled in Texas in the SB 8 situation, but now I guess he's got a problem.
Indeed he does. More than one, if you ask me. Stick around, you guys. We're right back. We're going to talk about pasta. Stay with us.
Hi, this is Fred Dwyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Do you want to fly somewhere? Anywhere in the world? Smart travelers call myflightsearch.com for the best deals on flight tickets. Going to Manila, Bangkok, London, how about Singapore? Call myflightsearch.com for the lowest flight tickets available. What about a local vacation? Let's say you want to fly to Vegas, Orlando, Miami, Los Angeles, or Denver. Pick up the phone and call myflightsearch.com right now. We have exclusive deals that you can't find anywhere else. The only way you can get these low airline prices is by calling us. We have so many low prices available, we can't possibly tell them to you right here and now. If you're flying somewhere anytime in the next 6 months and you want the lowest airline ticket prices anywhere, you owe it to yourself to save a ton of money. So pick up your cell phone and call myflightsearch.com right now.
Call 800-445-3166. 800-445-3166. That's 800-445-3166. Call now. 800-445-3166.
If Ernest Hemingway was alive today, would he say this to you?
Shakespeare, Mark Twain, Edgar Allan Poe, all great writers. And after reading your book, I simply must add you to the list.
Wait, you don't have a book yet. So make a free call to Page Publishing. Their expert staff can help you turn your book idea into a real book, a masterpiece that could someday make the bestseller list in hard copy and digitally all across the world. Page Publishing can help you completely take your idea for a book, write it, and publish it. So if you want to join the ranks of some of the most famous authors in the world, call now for a free information kit. Turn your book idea into publishing gold. Make a free call right now to Page Publishing.
800-378-3212. 800-378-3212. 800-378-3212. That's 800-378-3212.
All right, we're back in the Legal Lounge. Not a lot of time, but we really want to get to this story because it's a good one. This is has to do with pasta. We have Richard, of course, is a son of Italy. We also have Mr. G in studio as well, who's a proud son of Italy as well. And all three of us really enjoy pasta. And Barilla, which is a very large Italian-based pasta company, they make dried pastas, sauces, accoutrements, and whatnot, they have been sued. A class action suit, and plaintiffs are seeking $5 million in damages from Barilla, saying that the brand misleads consumers into believing its products are produced in Italy. This lawsuit is moving forward, even though the case is after a federal judge threw up part of it. Richard, come on. I mean, this case, it's pasta. What are we talking about? So first of all, what harm would one actually have to bring an action saying because the pasta wasn't, quote, effective enough? And also, isn't this kind of an example of a frivolous lawsuit that sometimes unscrupulous attorneys engage in for a quick buck?
Well, yes and no. Depends on how it's handled. Here, we do have statutes on the books that say you can't mislead the public when it comes to products that they sell to the public. So if you're touting that this product is from Brazil when it's not, there's some value in that. It turns out in this particular case, at least the plaintiffs, all they've spent is like $6 for two people that they've bought this pasta for. But they're suing for $5 million. But as we said in our show prep, that $5 million comes from what is estimated as their revenue that they received as a result of the falsehood, if you will. And we won't go through the article entirely, but basically, both sides seem to have an argument. One side says, look, we publish on our pasta that this is a product of America, made in the USA with USA and imported ingredients. However, nowhere on the pasta does it say that this comes from Italy, although the jar or can or whatever box looks Italian, if you will. So is it misleading or not? And we have an expert here, Mr. G, who's been on the show before. In fact, we might one day just hire him outright because he's here all the time. Mr. G, are you familiar with these products?
Oh, yeah. They're good.
And?
Mr. G, do you feel you've been misled by Barilla and you were expecting to eat pasta directly from the boot, but yet it was actually made in Iowa?
I don't think so.
the on the box, it doesn't say anything about, you know, product of Italy or
right.
It's Italy's number one largest producer. You know,
the company's based in Italy. The founder is Italian. The current CEO is Italian.
Right.
And like you said, it says nowhere on the box it says made in Italy. In fact, says made in the United States. Right. But because of the way it's, you know, the languages and stuff like that, the imagery, the symbology, the semiotics, these plaintiffs think it's that they've been defrauded. There's an Italian restaurant in Glendale by my house that's called Two Guys from Italy.
Right.
Is that, even though they're in Glendale, can I sue them?
Well, what if it turns out they are from Italy? That's the point, see? But again, it gets kind of ridiculous. But again, it depends on how seriously you want to take some laws. Other people have said the law is an ass, and this might be a good example of that, where we're going after something that's not important. These people haven't really been damaged, but the consumers, in a sense, have been, because if they've been buying these products thinking that they're genuine Italian products, when they're not, they're made in Minnesota or Iowa, they've been, in a sense, defrauded. You might say it's kind of a peaceful defrauding, but they're entitled to some of that profit back.
All right, we're out of time. I wish we had more time to talk about this.
I don't blame you, Mike.
These plaintiffs better watch out, because this is a Baroli. They're based in Naples. They've been around since the late 19th century, and they better watch out. Some paisans don't come over. We'll see you guys next week on The Legal Lounge.